I'm sorry, I don't seem to have a button join panel.
Hi, Meka.
Hello.
So we are live right now, and this is the
Right.
recording started. We
Good.
have about 23 people at your session who have immediately joined. Can you see at the bottom of the screen? 23? Yeah. So enjoy your session.
Thank you. So am I in the panel now? Because I
Yeah,
didn't click anything.
there's no panel. The session is entirely yours. The button is
Oh,
that way. It might have.
perfect. So yeah, sure.
Stage is yours.
Thank you. So, hello, everybody. Thank you. Let me just share my screen. It's this one, just a minute. Right. And then let's get rid of. Well, thank you, first of all, for having me here. I guess it's good afternoon for you in India. I'm based in the Netherlands, and it's before noon right now. So welcome to this Ask Me Anything, where we'll discuss conversation design. The agenda of this meeting, let's see, is that I'll do a short introduction on conversation design in case you're not familiar with the topic. And after that, say about 10 minutes, I'll just hand over the floor to you and see whatever questions or discussion topics you may come up with. And let's see where that will bring us. Right. I'll just open the tab. Before we do that, short introduction about who I am. Hoi hoi, that's Dutch for hello and good afternoon. My name is Maaike Groenewegen, and I'm a conversation designer since 2019. Start of this year, I actually went independent as a conversation designer and a conversational consultant at my own company, ConvoCat. So I'm right in the middle of my first year as an entrepreneur. And before that, I already had quite a big career in tech writing, business analysis, and project management, amongst others with Dutch Air Traffic Control. I'm the founder of the Dutch chapter of Women in Voice. We have about 60 active members who strive to elevate women and get them heard in tech. And I recently started hosting a bi-weekly voice lunch, language and linguistics, together with Brielle Nikolov. So let's get to the main part of why we're here, conversation. Now, if you look at human conversation, then this probably looks quite familiar, right? Let's see. Can someone perhaps in the discussions indicate how many people we are already? Because I cannot see the numbers. Can some people perhaps say hi? 26. Wow, that's wonderful. Well, then it makes sense to continue. Thank you. It's because the thing is, I can't see you, right? I can only see my own screen. So it feels like I'm talking in the dark. So whenever you feel like chatting in the chat window, I can see the discussions. So, oh, this is lovely. Thank you so much. Now I feel like I'm actually talking to someone. And that's actually the main part of what makes conversation so natural for us, right? We're so used to talking to each other that we don't even realize how complex it is that we actually do. I mean, can you imagine by the age of six, all of us, you know, if we don't have too many problems with hearing, we actually manage to learn a language and speak our own language as a native speaker without any kind of formal training. So something that looks so easy to us, for me is actually a miracle. And I still wonder every day at the miracle of what language and conversation is. So yeah, how hard can it be, you think, right? Like, okay, for us, we are instinctively fluent in conversation. And when we talk to our voice assistants and our chatbots, we actually expect the same behavior and fluency from them as well. Well, I don't know about you, but I think with the current state of chatbots and voice, we still are a far cry of this natural and fluent conversation, right? I mean, look at the first bot. I think that you all will agree that, yeah, that's quite kind of a stupid bot. The second one is doing slightly better, you know, delivery or pickup. I choose pickup. And then I think, oh, the times are actually not that good for me. So I change to delivery. And this is something that humans do all the time. We change our minds when we talk. We hardly ever have a linear conversation that goes straight from A to B without any kind of detours. And for us, it's natural, but for chatbots and voice assistants, it's still very difficult to manage and to follow. And then there's, of course, context. Look at this chatbot. I mean, it's a lovely chatbot. I really like using this one, but bonjour, how would you describe the term bot to your grandma? And then the user says, my grandma is dead. Oops. And then the bot replies with, all right, thank you for your feedback. We as humans, of course, would be much more empathetic. We would say something like, oh, I'm so sorry for your loss. For bots, this is something that is not obvious. It's not automatic. It's something you have to cater for. So most conversational problems that we encounter in our chatbots are actually design problems. Because, you know, if you look at the last case, we could have easily built a turn that says, you know, or a condition where if you find a keyword like, you know, dead or ill or fired, you could actually program your bot to be more empathetic to that context. So design is something that's very important in this stage of conversational AI. And that is where we come in, people like me, conversation designers. And what is it that we do? Well, we actually, to be really kind of, you know, simple, we teach machines to speak human and not the other way around. I love this quote. It's actually from Google. It's not mine, but it's a very important one. So what we do is we take all the research that has been done on human conversation, because there's literally decades of research there already. And we take that with us to shape the UX of our conversational experience. It's quite a new profession. I mean, I've only been in it for 2 years and I'm already considered a veteran. And it's got some wonderful job opportunities as well, because conversational interfaces are really the future. And the more helpful and the more persuasive and the more pleasant these interfaces are, the more likely people are to use them and to return to your company. So lovely job, lovely profession. Now, some of these principles of human conversation, I'll keep it brief, but there's one that I think that every conversation designer should know, and you probably already know it. The cooperative principle by linguist and philosopher Paul Grice. Now, he stated that when you and me, when we talk, we have the implicit agreement that we are going to do our very best to understand each other. And we're actually going out of our way to make that happen. And the beauty is that we do that completely unconscious. We're not even aware of it. And we actually do that by following four maxims or guidelines, the maxim of quantity, where we promise to each other that we're going to be as informative as possible, but only also not to give more information than is needed per term in a conversation. The maxim of quality is that we promise that we won't lie or tell blatant untruths. So whenever I say something, you should be able to rely on me, like, okay, this is the actual truth, right? We also promise the maxim of relation, that we are going to stay relevant to the topic, And I guess, I mean, you probably know this friend, right? Who kind of wanders off into the woods, like discussing everything and nothing at the same time. And sometimes it's quite hard to follow these conversations. So especially for virtual assistants, it's really important that you manage to stay on topic or go back to topic when you kind of wander off. And finally, the maximum manner is that we try to avoid ambiguity. So be as clear, as concise as possible. Now, these go for human conversation, but they're actually beautiful guidelines for designing your virtual assistant as well. How am I doing time-wise? Yeah, I can do one more, right? Turn-taking, I'll just touch that briefly. Contrary to graphical user interfaces or documents, turn-taking, you know, conversation is driven by turn-taking. So I take a turn, you take a turn. And turn-taking is basically the navigation of our conversations. So that's something that a virtual assistant also needs to be able to do. Now, we humans, we're really good at turn-taking. If you kind of felt quite uncomfortable by this silence, that's because somewhere in your primitive brain, something started to ask, is it her turn or is it actually my turn? We kind of all kinds of subtle mechanisms to let somebody know whether it's their turn or our turn. We can take a turn, we can cough, we can ask a question, we can use non-verbal cues like or even our faces. Of course, virtual assistants cannot do that. So we have to design for explicit turn-taking signaling. And one of the best practices is, of course, to end every bot turn with a cue or a prompt or a question. So that's that one. And the final principle, especially for voice, because voice is still relatively new. Not many people are already really comfortable with using a voice interface. So we have to make sure that we really know the context in which they use it and whether it's appropriate for voice. I mean, imagine being in this really busy Dutch train in, morning commute. Imagine being the lady on the left and imagine having a voice-driven female health tracker. Well, as you can obviously think, imagine it's not a very comfortable position if it starts, screaming all this kind of private details in a busy environment, right? So that's a part of our job to make sure that the medium is actually suited to the context. And the final topic that I briefly wanted to address, because it's also input for our discussion, is what is it that a conversation designer does? Well, I'm a conversation designer. I work in this field every day. So I thought I'd just make a small list of some of my everyday tasks. And they're quite diverse. I spend a lot of time, because I work in a corporate environment, I spend a lot of time doing use case analysis. So finding out which topics, which problems are actually suited for solving with a conversational interface. Because, some use cases might be better off with a solution on a website. Others might be better off with a voice assistant or a chatbot. So I do a lot of stakeholder analysis, a lot of information analysis, business analysis as well. And once we've got the use case clear and we know it's going to be in a conversational interface like voice or chatbot, then we start, because I've got a team, with the dialogue design. And we first start with the high over happy flow. So the end-to-end path from problem to solution, from question to answer. And it's very high level. We don't bother with the details or let alone the coding. We don't do that yet. A very important part of my work is designing for fallback and error recovery, because no one's going to follow your happy flow. That's just our assumption of what the world will look like to our users. But in reality, they will ask all kinds of questions that your bot can't answer. And that doesn't matter. It's perfectly all right, as long as your bot knows what to do when things go wrong and what to do to make sure that the conversation comes back on track. And that's also something you can design for. I spend a lot of time doing that. Of course, there's copywriting, because once the architecture is there, you also want to make sure that your bot is pleasurable to use, that it actually reflects your brand's tone of voice, but also that it's helpful and persuasive. And that's an art in itself, because you're not writing content, you're designing speech, you're designing conversation. So there's all kinds of techniques for that. And the last but definitely the most intensive one, testing. Once your bot goes live, that's only the start of things, because every day you get questions from your users and you have to analyze whether these questions are answered correctly, whether your bot has the answers, whether the matching between the user question and the bot answer is actually correct. So we usually even have a separate person in our team to do the analysis, but I help out a lot as well. So this is just, I only have 10 minutes, right, for an introduction. So this is very high over kind of overview. One more. That's my final slide, and then the floor is yours. The happy flow, my favorite method of designing that is doing it by sample dialogue. So I don't sit down with a piece of paper and start writing a document. I don't sit down and start coding. What I do is I sit down with my colleague, like in this picture, back to back, and we just start acting out whether the scenario where one person is the chatbot or voice assistant and the other person is the user. And by rerunning conversations again and again, talking to each other like we would be a user and a bot, you really find out what the conversational order of your flow can be. What is the most logical way to talk through this problem? And this saves you from all kinds of pitfalls. It saves you from diving into the details too soon. It saves you from diving into the code too soon. And most of all, it makes sure that your experiences are voice first. And that is what we want. Well, I hope my short presentation caused a lot of questions with you, because that's what I would like to suggest, that we now move on to the actual questions and answers. And is there anything you would like to know from me? And I'm not quite sure how we proceed right now. I think there might be someone moderating. So, do we have a moderator here? Or shall we do it ourselves? We've got a question from Sonia. I hope I pronounce your name correctly, and if not, my apologies. And the question is, do you also need to conduct user research before delving into the use case analysis? Absolutely. And this is actually part of the bigger, usually the kind of omni-channel strategy that companies have. Even before I start my use case analysis, in my case, there will probably already be a business case where we have outlined which channels will be used and which content will go to the chatbot or voice assistant and which content will go to the website. So I do use the user personas that are already available, and I do a lot of prototyping during the development. But yes, we do try to make use of existing research as much as possible. Yes, absolutely. Does that answer your question? I guess I'll just go on with the next one then. Oh, that's an interesting one. Conversational bots, it's by Sri actually. Conversational bots usually need the intent, and in some cases we don't get the intent to give a reply. How do you handle those corner cases? That is the challenge for every conversation designer indeed. Usually what I do is when I haven't got an entire area in my voice assistant or chatbot yet, I design what I call a gray intent. So I just make a catch-all for certain keywords and I make a generic reply that usually refers to parts of a website until the time we have enough information to start creating the flows for the actual intent in the voice assistant or chatbot or virtual assistant. So because you will never be able to catch all intents and all questions in one release, you have to do some kind of, you know, development, some kind of road mapping. So if we notice that questions are asked a lot by people, because we do analysis on that, then we put it on a roadmap and we make sure that there's like a general intent at first that just refers to a website, and that gives us the time to develop proper flows for that as well. Yeah. Right, let's see. And then we've got a question on resources by Nitin. What are some of the best resources which we can refer to get background on conversation design? Well, actually, I brought you some. I created a slide, so I guess I have to share my slides again. I think the slides are shared after the conference as well. Let me see. For share, and then I need to go to there we go. I've got an entire section on when you want to get started on conversation design. So my advice would always be to start building a bot yourself. So I put some resources down. Dialogflow, obviously. Voiceflow is lovely. If you're Alexa minded, great. And I guess because we're on an Indian conference, I should definitely recommend Engadget. It's one of my favorite platforms to do, like, you know, easy entry, low code, but very advanced bots. I've got some of my own articles. I've got a publication on Medium, which is called Great Conversations, where I share conversation design tips and tricks, especially on voice. And we've got communities, of course. If you're a woman, then Women in Voice, obviously. And we've got some Women in Voice in this conference as well. There's an Indian chapter. Voice Lounge, definitely worth checking out. We've even got an Indian Voice Lounge as well. It's where the voice community comes to eat and share resources and information. And these, for me, are the standard books. I'll keep it a bit longer so you can make a screenshot. Kathy Pearl, obviously, she is, for me, she's like the pioneer in voice design. And whenever you say conversation design, she's my go-to. Another one that I'm really a fan of is Robert Moore. He's with IBM, and he actually wrote a book on conversational UX patterns. So what he does, he gives examples from human natural language and converts them into patterns that you can use as inspiration for designing your conversational experience. Very, very useful. Voice user interface design by Jangola and a lot of other people is actually quite an old book. It's on IVRs, but it lays out the foundation of conversation design in such great detail and high quality that it's a classic. It's timeless. And Rachel Battish, she's also one to check out, definitely. So, yeah. I think, there's one more question by, I think it's either Rachael or Rachel Holborn. How I came to work in conversation design. I've got a background in linguistics, indeed. I'm a phonetician by origin. So I studied sound and sound structures in language. Unfortunately, there wasn't really that much work in that field when I graduated, which is like long, 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 long time ago. So this made me so happy to discover that there's actually so much linguistics in conversation design, because one of the things I do is actually train the natural language processing, define the intents and the entities, and then it really helps if you know something about linguistics. So yes, I'm really happy to be back in the field after 20 years. Oh, I love this question. Is it easy for non-coders to create a voice bot? By Supriya Kulkarni. Oh, Kulkarni, sorry, my eyes are not that good. I get this question a lot, and to be honest, I don't code. And I think it's an advantage because it allows you to really focus on the conversation without getting into all the nitty-gritty. I must say that designing conversational interfaces, it's not like your regular copywriting job. So it's not just text, it's not linear. You really need to have some kind of analytical mind. And I always compare it to, you know, if you enjoy doing like crypto puzzles or, you know, Sudoku, that kind of puzzles, that mindset is the one that you need for conversation design as well. So some kind of logic and a love for logic, a love for solving puzzles, that's what will get you the furthest, I guess. I must admit that I'm slightly learning to program now, but in a very passive way, so that I can be a better conversational partner for my developers in my team. And yeah, it's a bit of system design as well sometimes. Oh, let's see. Can you please share? That's from Nagesh. Can you please share examples of the methods used for user research and testing? I can. I don't have slides, unfortunately, but the most important point I think I'd like to make is that you start prototyping as soon as possible with real users. So bring your bot live in some kind of test environment as soon as possible. If you can't, or if you're not in that stage yet, then another method would be Wizard of Oz testing, where you actually give one person the role of the chatbot. You have all the possible examples on cards, and you basically do the sample dialogue again, but this time only with the answers that you actually designed beforehand. And that is also like a lo-fi method of prototyping and testing. But for me, what works best is just put the bot live and analyze, analyze, analyze. Perhaps first create a focus group with your intended target audience. And as soon as you feel, it's getting there, increase the volume of your users, because that's the information you need and the information you're looking for. Other user research, I guess it's not much different. Well, no, that's not completely true. I wanted to say it's not much different than regular UX research. But what I do find is that regular UX research is sometimes a bit too high level for the amount of detail that I need for my virtual assistants. It's great to have like a generic user persona. But what I really need to build a good bot is insight into the actual tasks that a user performs and their level of expertise, for instance. Am I building for a novel user or an experienced one? Is the task more like an administrative task or more executive? And what is the order of the tasks and what can go wrong? So my background as a technical writer really helped there, because in a way, voice assistants and chatbots can also be seen as, you know, manuals 4.0, where you basically have a lot of how-tos. And in technical communication, we have this thing called user task analysis with top tasks and, you know, more detailed tasks. And these help me really in designing flows. Gosh. You're welcome, Sukhi. Yeah. Oh, well, brand strategist, right? Actually, it's great to hear that you're one. I think it's a lovely way to actually move into this space, because a big deal of especially voice assistants is, you know, creating an extension of your brand. And you can leave the technical details to the techie guys. They love it. And girls, of course. I'm sorry. How are we doing time-wise? Because I have no idea how much time I have. Let's see. Elfirtach. I think I have about 5 minutes left. So perhaps one or two questions or just experiences. I mean, do you use chatbots and voice assistants in your own personal life? And what's your most annoying experience with them? Oh, this is an interesting one again from Supriya. Is it possible to have two voice bots together? You mean like if I talk to my smart speaker and that you actually have one bot talking to the other? Yes and no. It's not really possible yet, as far as I know, to have, for instance, IKEA talk to Lego, or have an Indian voice bot talk to a Dutch one, which I would love, because I love singing Indian classical music. So I would really love to have some kind of voice bot on that, where I can actually learn the pronunciation of the Hindi and the Sanskrit, right? But what I did do myself is create a story for a smart speaker where I had like two characters, and I each gave them different voice characteristics, and I kind of tweaked dialogue flow in this case so that it looked or sounded like you were actually having a conversation with two characters in one voice action. But that is like, it's really a matter of design and storytelling. So it's not technologically possible yet. No. But it would be nice though. Another thing that comes to mind is, it would be great if after speaking to, I don't know, a bank on a smart speaker, you could actually have some kind of hyperlink from that voice assistant to another one, rather than just quitting and have to find another voice action on your smart speaker again. You're most welcome. Let's see if we have some more. I mean, I could go on like this forever, but I know that we're on a really tight schedule. So I guess that if I don't hear anything from the organization, we can go on. Let's see if I have anything else left for you. No, not really. Yeah, I'm actually really happy to talk to any of you. I'll put my contact details slide for you to take a picture. I'm on LinkedIn, I'm on Twitter, and on Voice Lunch, basically every Monday and Tuesday. So that's definitely the place to also catch me if you want. Right. Gosh, we're 46 people. This is really amazing. I didn't even realize. Thank you so much, everybody. I mean, that's something I forgot to tell, but something that is just so amazing to me. I mean, you're all there and I'm here in the Netherlands, and we're actually able to share. I mean, how wonderful is that? That's really another miracle. So with that, I suggest that we leave it at this. Thank you very much for joining me. I hope you found it useful. And hope to see you online sometime. Bye.